how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. For I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. The prodigal is welcomed home. The sinner now is saint. For the God who died came back to life, and everything has changed. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, fear, where is your power? The mighty King of Kings has disarmed you. Delivered and redeemed, eternal life is ours. Oh, praise his name forever. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Sweet embrace, I see your scars, your open arms, and the beauty of your face. Through tears of joy, I lift my voice in everlasting praise. Hallelujah! Christ is risen from the grave. Oh, death, where power, the mighty King of Kings.
Good morning, church family. Good morning. It's good to see everyone today. Welcome. Let's bow our heads before the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, and we thank you for such a wonderful fellowship we have, the commonality we have in our church body here of being redeemed by you, having your Holy Spirit indwell us, God. We thank you that as we have that, we come together to lift your name in praise and to be taught by your word and have your spirit apply it to our lives. Bring us to that place where we clear out distraction, God, and are able to focus our attention on what you would have for us this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome, welcome again, and we've got a couple of announcements if you want to open up your church bulletin and take a look at those. Some of them are repeat, and some of them are things that you may want to write down for information for the future. And if you came unaware today, want to let you know that there is an invitation to you all to join us for lunch after church out at, how's it pronounced, Haydu Park in Kalama, is that right? Okay, so we're going to head out there right after the second service. Pick up your lunch, wherever you're going to grab lunch. Head out there. We've got some big canopies for some shade. And bring, if you didn't bring chairs or a blanket or something, the grass is nice to sit on as well. And we'll have some games and just a nice time until the sun drives us out of there. So we'll enjoy that time together. But we're also... I want to announce we're looking forward to that church at the park coming up August 21st. And that will be, the whole church service will be over at Tam O'Shanter Park. And then we'll have times of recreation after that and a meal that will provide barbecuing burgers and dogs and such. If you're a guest with us today, I want to remind you that we have guest cards in the pockets of the chairs in front of you. If you'd like to fill one out, we could have a record of your visit and information to be in contact with you. There are some needs at our church to make you aware of. I announced last week that we could use some more people helping on the cleaning of the building rotation, about a once-a-month rotation. We've got a couple of responses on that, so I'm really grateful. That'll help fill out our rotation. We're also looking for, in the fall, in mid-September, we're going to kick off Sunday school again, and some of the children's Sunday school classes could use some more volunteers. We have a good set of helpers. We could use a couple more lead teachers. Or we could use teachers who come in on a substitute basis a couple times during the quarter. So if you're interested in working with children, I think preschool, early elementary, upper elementary school, those specifically are the ages that we're looking for some volunteers for. Second thing we're looking for are volunteers who could help with grounds. In various ways, we've got Jeremy Fry does most of the mowing, edging, blowing. But when it comes to Sunday morning, if we could have somebody come in and give a little bit of time, especially this time of year, because we have a tree out front that just drops a ton of leaves, and then sometimes the aphids make this little sticky stuff you've noticed out front. So sweeping or cleaning up some of that would help. So if you're interested in serving in that way, we'd love to have you be a part of that as well. After the conclusion of worship, of course, we have childcare downstairs for younger kids, and we want to invite you to be able to take advantage of that if you wish. We want to welcome back some of our members and volunteers who have gone to the Royal Family Kids Camp this past week, and it was a week set aside for giving a camp away from home, sleepaway camp experience for foster kids or kids who have been in the foster care system. And boy, did they have a tremendous time. I got to be here for their welcome back and their celebration on Friday. And we had Josh Cox and Anna Cox and Tyler Tremaine and Luis Alvarez all get to go for the week and be a part of that experience. So we're praising the Lord for that. It's a tremendous effort, and it makes a difference in these kids' lives, we believe. So praying that the Lord reaches their hearts as a result of that ministry. I think that's it for announcements. So if you have questions about any of the things I've announced, come find me after the service. Yes? Yeah, oh yes, youth camp is a week from tomorrow, the beach camp for middle school and high school students. And we're going to have them for Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday down at Rockaway Beach. And we've got a good group of students and staff that are going to be a part of that. We're really excited for it. And it's in your bulletin on the green flyer that has a summary of prayer requests. Milo put forward some specifics to that, but we want to be praying for them before the week, things to come together during the week for God's Spirit and His Word working through our time together, and then after the week, just praying that the fruit of the work that's gone into those days will continue to bring glory to God in the weeks and months afterwards. So we want to pray for that. There's several people who have been suffering from various illnesses and sicknesses, and so we continue to lift them up in prayer as well. And take note of that summary sheet that's in your bulletin and keep that for the week. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the week that you gave to the Royal Family Kids and those volunteers from the bridge who went along to serve in that way. We pray that you would bring about the fruit that you desire for your glory and for the good of those kids that were there. We pray for the upcoming beach camp for our youth here, and we want to pray that the preparations would still come together this week, this final week before the camp. There would be direction and wisdom given by you for those leaders that are preparing, and the hearts would be prepared of the students who are going to go and the students who are friends of our students that are being brought as well. I want to pray, God, that this time there would be a working of your Spirit that is unto new life or the abundant life that you've already given to many of them. We praise you for that, God, and we give you thanks for the work that you do in us, through us. Thank you for this day, Lord. Let us lift your name on high in worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our wildest sea, you are.
To the Lord of heaven and earth.
Beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy. We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength today. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He! And together we sing in this very room. Everyone sing to Him. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He! And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. It's rising up all around. It's the we A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amidst a flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe does seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. We're not ask who that may be. Christ Jesus, it is He, the Lord of hosts, His name, and age to age the same. And He must win the battle. And though this world with how great the chasm
that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Sing hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of Heaven. And it's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy, Lord, I come. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. I bring an offering to you. Sing, the sun cannot compare. The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of Heaven. And it's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy, Lord, I come. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh, Lord, I bring an offering to you. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh, Lord, I bring an offering to you. Oh, Lord, I bring an offering to you. Oh, Lord, I bring an offering to you. I bring my offering to you. Lord, this morning we give you an offering of praise. Be moved, Lord, by what you hear this morning, God. May our voices reach your heart today, giving you glory for all that you are and all that you've done throughout history, in our lives, God. For all you've done, Lord, we bring an offering of praise to you. God, we give you our hearts, our lives, our time, and our praise, Lord, our voices. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. All right, I'll be reading the text today, Colossians chapter 3, verses 5 through 11. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you: sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desires, and covetousness, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming. In these you too once walked, when you were living in them. But now you must put them all away: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of its creator. Here, therefore, is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. Lord God, I just thank you for this body of believers that we get to gather and just hear your word preached. We pray that we receive the truth that you have for us and help us just to have our minds renewed by it. We just thank you for the work that Pastor Joe has put in, and we just thank you for him and what you're doing in our lives, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
I hope you have your Bibles with you today, and we're going to be doing Bible drills. Now, I'm going to be taking you from one passage to another to look at the various things that this text has to teach us. And basically, when it comes to this passage, does anybody else hear a tune going off? Yeah, there's something going. It's from back there. Oh, a kid's toy. So the passage we're going to be looking at today, I'm not going to go through it in the same order I usually may do, but what we are doing is going for the what, the why, the who, and the how. And so I'll take you through that, each of those individually, the what, the why, the who, and the how, as we go through this passage. The text that we're looking at... Well, just as a precursor, some of you may remember from the 80s and 90s, there were several health concerns going on in the United States, specifically with the spread of certain disease. And so the strategy that the government took on was that they would begin to lessen the effects of what they called so-called risky behavior. And so, not to be too graphic, but they decided that in schools they would begin to distribute certain products that would help prevent the spread of HIV and STDs and unwanted teen pregnancies. The thought behind it being at the time that the risky behavior or the behavior that leads to this, they're going to do anyway. So why not try to minimize that? That led, that same type of thinking led to not trying to prevent people from using intravenous drugs, but instead to have a clean needle exchange program. So that in that case, instead of preventing the behavior, it's let's make that behavior as safe as possible. And that led to another strategy which had to do with crack smoking use, that there was a danger with that. I'm not familiar with all the specifics, but the Canadian Interior Health Department produced this harm reduction plan that was going to help not eliminate the problem, but help make the problem safer when it was endeavored in. And then pamphlets were printed off and distributed that would, because the part of the idea was if we can just give people more information, then they'll go about their practices in more safe ways. Do you see any problem with these things, these strategies? Well, part of it is this. The safe smoking kits vary from one organization to another. There's also various programs to do these things, but the idea of mitigating sinful behavior when it comes to spiritual health is impossible when it comes to just trying to make the sinful behavior just safer. All of these harm reduction techniques might make some sense on an earthly level, but they make absolutely zero sense when it comes to spiritual life. There is no program. There is no measure that can be taken, nor any cost. Even though those programs cost tens of millions of dollars, there is no cost that can actually help when it comes to the sin and the condition of man. You see, the wages of sin is death. We must not seek to mitigate the harm of it. Rather, we must seek to get rid of it. Sin is always harmful. We come to a passage like this today, and some people say, ooh, that's heavy, or do you have to talk about that, or something like that. But this is a glorious passage. This is really good news for us to see. And I hope that by the end, you see where I'm going with it. Well, James has told us in James chapter 1, verse 15, that when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. What a graphic image. When desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is fully grown, it brings forth death. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 11, Paul tells us, "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor greedy, nor drunkards, nor rivalers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and by the Spirit of our God." Amen. John chapter 8, verse 34. Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin." Romans 6, 10 through 12. "The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires." Our text in Colossians chapter 3 has another parallel, a parallel in Romans chapter 8, verse 13. This is also the memory verse that's printed on the front of your bulletin, Romans 8, 13. "If you are living according with your with the flesh, or in accord with the flesh, you are going to die. But if by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live." Any of you were Christians back in the 80s? Some of you here, a few of you, okay. Do you remember a Christian rock band called Petra? Several of you do. I used to love them. I listen to them all the time. Petra had this song called "Killing My Old Man," "Killing My Old Man," which is a pretty startling title to a song until you realize what he's talking about is the sin nature and the battle with the sin nature. He said in the song, "I think it's gone far enough and I can't take it anymore. I've got to even up the score before he sweeps me off the floor. I've really got to find a way of taking care of him for good. I know he'd kill me if he could, so I'll nail him to the wood." This idea that's being expressed there is the same one that's here in Colossians. It's the same one in Romans. It's the same one in Galatians. There's several places where this idea is being expressed. And what you realize is that the inspired authors of the New Testament put these terms rather violently together. The picture of killing sin is a violent picture. It's an aggressive picture. Now, based on chapter 8, verse 13, based on that verse, a man named John Owen wrote a little book called The Mortification of Sin. Mortification of Sin. He wrote it in the year 1656, and today the English version, which is updated, the more common English language it's updated to, is about 176 pages long. So it's a little, pretty little book, The Mortification of Sin. Mortification is another word for killing. And he addresses this topic throughout the entire book. But one of the quotes I wanted to bring to you from his book today is, he asks, "Do you mortify? Do you make it your daily work? Be always at it whilst you live. Cease not a day from this work. Be killing sin, or it will be killing you." Powerful words. I wanted to, somebody brought it to my attention this week, and I wanted to share it with you as well. I very, very seldom read a text of Scripture from the Message version, which the Message is a paraphrased version put in modern-day English, but I thought it expressed some of the sentiment of this passage well. I wouldn't probably agree with everything in a paraphrase in this case, but I thought some of it was expressed well, so I wanted to share it with you. Colossians 3:5-11. And that means killing off everything connected with that way of death. Sexual promiscuity, impurity, lust, doing whatever you feel like, whenever you feel like it, and grabbing whatever attracts your fancy. That's a life shaped by things and feelings instead of by God. It's because of this kind of thing that God is about to explode in anger. It wasn't long ago you were doing all that stuff and not knowing any better, but you know better now. So make sure it's all gone for good. Bad temper, irritability, meanness, profanity, dirty talk. And don't lie to one another. You're done with that old life. It's like a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes that you've stripped off and put in the fire. Now you're dressed in a new wardrobe. Every item of your new way of life is custom made by the Creator with His label on it. The old fashions are now obsolete. Words like Jewish, non-Jewish, religious, irreligious, insider, outsider, uncivilized, uncouth, slave, and free mean nothing. From now on, everyone is defined by Christ. Everyone is included in Christ. So back to the passage we're looking at. The first question I was going to give you is what? What? What is the sin? Well, Paul gives us a list here. We know, and you and I know, that if you read in other places of Scripture, there are other lists that have other terms and other words that are used. So this is not an exhaustive list. This list given to us in Colossians 3:5-11 is not an exhaustive list of everything. If you can say, well, I can check off each of these and they're eliminated from my life, they're put to death. If you can look at each of those and say that, are you done? No, certainly not. But this list is a list of a selection of examples of sins that Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, has given us here. In the other places in Scripture, there are other things that are also described as sinful and things to be put off and not to be a part of a Christian life. And when you come to those, you're to read those as if they're given by the authority of God and the inspiration of God. So they're to be submitted to as well, those words of exhortation. But these designations from God's word are all authoritative for our lives, and they reveal God's mind on these things. And when we, as his creatures who have been redeemed, we've been transferred from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his marvelous son, when we see these words, we say, Lord, I should have no part with those things. Well, here's the list. It starts off with five things at the beginning, then there's another few things, five or six things after that. In verse 5, it starts off with sexual immorality. In some older translations or some other translations, it's translated fornication. The Greek word is porneia, which is where we get our English word pornography from. And it has to do with a broad umbrella of sexual actions that are outside of marriage, therefore not sanctioned as holy or given by God. So outside of marriage, that one's listed here, fornication or sexual immorality. The second one's impurity. The word here means uncleanness, physically or spiritually uncleanness. It can be used both ways. The third word is passion. Now, you might ask, is passion not a good thing? Well, in this case, the context would tell us that it's inordinate or it is out of order, an affection or a lust for something that is very passionate, that it isn't proper. So it's overboard, but it's pathos is the Greek word for that. Then we have evil desire. Evil desire. It could also be translated wicked or sinful desire or lust. So lust is included in several of these right off the bat. And then finally, covetousness, which is idolatry. Covetousness. Some translations call it greed. It can be also translated or understood, defined as a craving or a longing or a desire for what is forbidden. It's covetousness. Wanting to have something that you can't righteously have, desiring it strongly. And then the author of this book, Paul, says, which is idolatry? I want to take some time in a few minutes to look at the topic of idolatry, but somehow there's a connection made at this point. Just note that, covetousness, which is idolatry. You go down to verses 8 and 9, and it starts taking on, I don't know if it's another category, but it's another portion of the list that we're given here in Colossians, and it starts off with anger. 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 Goes right to the heart. Well, we know, and you might ask, is all anger sin? And we have the example for us of Jesus Christ himself expressing what appears to be anger in the overturning of tables in the temple when he went through. But look carefully at that incident, and what was it that he was reacting to? What was it that he was demonstrating? He was demonstrating the sinful heir of God's good name and God's house, God's honor being impugned. So Jesus expressed a righteous indignation, a righteous anger at the honor and glory of his Father. And so often our anger is more self-focused. And I think that's one of the things we have to watch out for. Anger, because he is really wanting to zero in on the definitions here, because he says anger, and then he says wrath, and then he says malice, and then he says slander. So it seems like combine these all together and you've got some difficult things that are addressing the heart here. Wrath is a passionate anger, a heated anger, which is boiling up and then perhaps even soon subsiding. So flare-ups of anger when it says wrath, something that can come upon you and then forget about. So it's explosiveness, I would say, in temper. And perhaps that's something you've struggled with, or you know somebody who has been in your life that has really had this have a foothold in their life and it's spilled over onto you. Anger, wrath, and malice. What is malice? Malice is that ill will towards another, a desire to injure, not ashamed to break laws. Interesting definitions here, but wanting something bad to come across the other person. So anger, wrath, malice. And then finally in that grouping, slander. Slander, you know, has to do with your speech. A detraction or a speech that would be injurious to another's good name. I don't think these words have left any of us untouched. What is Paul addressing? The condition of our heart. But he's saying that these things are not fitting anymore to those of you who have been redeemed by the Lord. They're not fitting for you. They don't belong. The real question is, what is it that he's identifying in me that needs to be put to death? Because that's how the verse starts, put it to death. The next thing he goes on to talk about is obscene talk. Now this can be done completely apart from anger, wrath, or malice, or slander. Obscene talk can be done with a joking attitude, a lighthearted, laughing kind of attitude, or it can be a cursing kind of expression. It means foul speaking, low or obscene speech, vile conversation, filthy communication. And I'm so pleased that I really don't hear this in my conversations with our church body. And it could be sometimes people clean things up when they're talking with the pastor. And I've had people when I tell them I'm a pastor, they say, oh, I'm sorry for, you know, what I was saying. begin to apologize for that. But I have dear friends who go to Bible-believing, Bible-teaching churches where it is the common practice to say no big deal to speaking in foul language, which is upsetting to me. It's kind of shocking because I really believe that even though it's become so acceptable in our day and our culture to hear believers justifying or defending foul language, saying, well, it's only words. Or they take a piece of scripture and they try to justify, see, this is kind of off color in the scripture, so isn't that the same thing as what we're talking about? Or trying to make equivalent parallels in the scripture. I believe that the new life that we've been given should look different than the culture around us. Guard your tongue. Speak with words of life, truth, purity, pleasing to the Lord. And I know that when you've been in certain situations at work where you hear it all the time, or you've grown up and you heard it all the time, or even spoke it all the time, it can be a tough habit to break. You hear it in your mind, and then in a moment of passion or pain or something like that, it can slip out. God is a gracious God. All of our sin, when we believe in Him, when we trust in Him, all of our sins covered, right? And yet He calls us to something higher. We'll get into that a little bit more. But I would say if that's something that is a practice, seek the Lord on it. Not only do we have this passage here talking about obscene talk, you could go to Ephesians 4:29, where it says, let no unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is beneficial that it might benefit, or what is good and beneficial that it might benefit those who listen, something to that effect. Somebody else brought up in our staff meeting this week, our ministry leaders meeting this week, that every spoken word will have an accountability, will be accounted for. Now, I know there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ, but at the same time, there is a call to live higher and to live different. And so we must desire to see this. Parents, teach this to your children. As a follower of Christ, we live different than the world around us, and that's okay. The goal is not to blend in, right? The last thing he says in verse 9 is, do not lie to one another. Lie, we're pretty familiar with, to speak a deliberate falsehood, to deceive one by a lie, or to lie to somebody. That should not be a part of our practice. Now back to the question about, in verse 5, about covetousness, which is idolatry. And the question, what is idolatry? I would say, after doing some study and some research on it this week, that idolatry has to do with flowing from the heart of God that is a loving jealousy. Here's why I say that. Why is it in this passage, why is it that it says that idols, why would you conclude that idols are, it's dangerous to have them? Well, verse 6, because of these, the wrath of God is coming. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. And nothing is more dangerous than the wrath of an omnipotent, all-righteous God. Why would that be? Take you back to Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20, that's the, if you recall, it's the giving of the Ten Commandments, where God says and writes in stone, but he says to Moses, you shall not make for yourselves carved image or any likeness or anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. This jealous connection comes into the command right here. Now, of course, we think about this. The wrath of God comes to the idolater because God is a jealous God. And you know in your mind, and some people have had a hard time with this use of jealousy connected with God. So there is a type of righteous jealousy, and there's a type of low and unrighteous, weak, insecure jealousy. And they're two different things. God is jealous in a way that is not only righteous, but he's jealous in a way that's also loving. God deserves our deepest and strongest affections. He fully deserves our deepest, strongest affections. He deserves our admiration. And so that's why I would say it's loving for him. It's a loving jealousy because we're made to find, we should be finding our greatest joy, our greatest satisfaction in who he is. Our purpose is clarified and elevated in him, not in ourselves or anything on the earth below. The greatest command is that we love the Lord our God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength. So he's jealous that he would be honored and he would be loved with all of us. If we find God to be, for example, if we find God to be so boring or unfulfilling that we must put something else in his place that brings fulfillment, that not only offends him, but it destroys us, right? It offends him and it destroys us. And because of those things, and God's saying, I don't want those to be on your life, because of those things, the wrath of God is coming. What is an idol? What looks like an idol today? Well, it has to do with God being in first place in our heart. So verse 5, when it says covetousness, which is idolatry, what it looks like today is any activity of the human heart that is a craving or a wanting or an enjoying or a being fulfilled by anything that you love or cherish more than God. That's an idol. Paul calls this covetousness, or it's a disordered love or desire, loving something more than God, something that specifically should be loved. Potentially, it should be loved, but if it is loved, less than God. So Paul puts it like this in Romans 1, verse 25. Romans 1:25, and you're familiar with this when we say it. They exchanged the truth about God for a lie, and they worship and serve the creature, right? They worship and serve the creature rather than the creator. The creature, anything that is created, rather than the creator. But there is no wrath for the children of God. Why is that? Paul said, 1 Thessalonians 1, verses 9 and 10, you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God, to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. Yeah. So that is the what of this passage. What are the sins? What is idolatry? What is he talking about here? Now I want to have us go over a little bit to the why. Why should I be killing sin? Why kill sin? Well, I get some help here from a book that I'm rereading now called Devoted to God by Sinclair Ferguson. And he helps us in this. He says that holiness, and remember, here's the connection. Our desire to be holy as God is holy, which is a command from him, is the same thing as our desire to see sin eradicated and put to death. So getting rid of the old life, the flesh, and coming to a place where I am set apart, I am holy, I'm set apart for his purposes, for his glory. Those are, that we're talking about the same thing. So what he says here is holiness is not just a desire of the Trinity, it's a specific command. And therefore, a commandment of God the Father. As he who called you is holy, be holy, for I am holy. One, and that phrase is in several places, but one of the places where that we find that phrase is in Leviticus chapter 19. Leviticus chapter 19, he says, be holy, for I am holy. And that's a chapter that's really expanding on the law of God. It's expanding some of the Ten Commandments that we got from Exodus chapter 20. But it's as though God is saying, all of these commandments that I've given you can be summed up in that single principle, you are to be holy because I am holy. In other words, God is saying, be like me. Be like me in your separation from sin, in your separation from this world. Be like me and devoted to God, God's honor, God's glory, God's moral purity. And then when we get to the New Testament, we learn that there is another summation of this, and that the fulfillment of the commandments is really fulfilled in love for God and love for others. And that suggests that holiness and love are not as far apart as we might think. Holiness and love do not exist apart from each other in that way, but as some people maybe have imagined it, but they have a symbiotic relationship. You know, symbiotic is that old scientific term of two parts that have to work together, and love and holiness are like that. Sanctification is growing. The process of you being set apart and I being set apart is growing in my love for God. Growing in my love for God. And to love God is to for me to be growing in holiness for him too. Now in the Romans 8:13 passage, it talks about if you're not doing that, if you're living according to the flesh, you will die. So you might ask the question, if the threat of death is real, does that mean that a person can lose their salvation? Well, you know the answer that I'm going to say. No, a person cannot lose their salvation. What we're talking about here is somebody who's been saved, somebody who's been justified by faith alone, apart from works of the law, cannot die in the sense of eternal death. One of the main reasons for believing this is also found in Romans chapter 8 when you go down to verse 30, and we looked at this a couple weeks ago, but it's called the golden chain. Paul argues that every part of salvation from beginning to end is a work of God, and every part of it is linked together. It's this unbreakable chain. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. So you've got this link between justification and glorification that is certain to happen. It is certain to happen. If you have been justified by faith, you will be glorified. You will be brought to eternal life and to glory. The chain will not be broken. The predestination, the calling, the justification, and the glorification are all linked together. So the question is, why does Paul say in Romans 8:13 to the church, he's writing to the church in Rome, if you are living according in accord with the flesh, you're going to die, but by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live. The reason that he's saying this to them is that putting to death the deeds of the body by the Spirit, the daily practice of killing sin in your life, is the result of being justified. You see that? The evidence that you've been justified, the evidence that you are saved, is that you are in a practice of killing sin. Apart from the works of the law, you are making war on sin in your life and walking by the Spirit. If you are doing that, you know you've been united with Christ by faith alone. The opposite is also true. If you're living in according to the flesh and you're not making war on sin in your life, then there's not really a compelling reason to think that you're united to Christ by his death, by your faith. In other words, putting to death the deeds of the body is not the way you get justified. It's one of the ways God shows that we're justified. Now, Paul asks this question in Romans chapter 6, which is great. He asks it two times. What shall we say then? What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace might increase? By no means. Absolutely not. Are we to continue in sin because we're not under the law but under grace? Verse 15. Absolutely not. So all of chapter 6 and chapter 7 of Romans are written to show us justification by faith alone, apart from works, does not and cannot lead a person to make peace with sin. It can't lead you to say, I'm okay with having sin be a resident, welcome guest in the home of my life. In Romans 6:2, how can we who died to sin still live in it? How can we who died to sin still live in it? We can't. If we died to sin by being united to Jesus in his death, we can't stay married to sin anymore. The faith, so some of you have different accounts of stories of when you came to faith in Jesus Christ. And when somebody presented the gospel and the Spirit of God took the blinders off of your eyes and you said, I get it. This is glorious. He went to the cross to take the wrath of God in my place. To come to Christ by faith is to start the trek of making war on sin. It is not what saves you, but it's a result of being saved. Okay, I think I've beat that horse. And in case you think this doesn't apply to you for some reason, well, I'm of this nationality or I'm of this background or heritage or circumstance, Paul says he wants to let us know that we're all together in salvation. This command to put sin to death is for all of us. And who is, and this is the third point, who is included in this command? All who are in Christ. All who are in Christ. In verse 11 it says, here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised, uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. Compare that to Galatians 3, 27 and 28. As many of you were baptized into Christ and, or it doesn't say and, have put on Christ, there is neither Jew nor Greek, neither slave nor free. There it says, there is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Now, one of my favorite commentators is John Gill, and he says on this verse, I think I've got the quote for you, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, that is either in Christ, after whose image the new man is created, or in the new man with respect to regeneration, it matters not of what nation a man is. This has no influence on his new birth, either to forward or hinder it. For he is never the more a new creature, a regenerate man, and interested in salvation because he is a Jew, which he may be outwardly and not inwardly. He may be born again, though he is a Greek or a Gentile. For God, of his own will and abundant mercy, and not out of respect to nations or and persons, begets souls again to a lively hope and of the heavenly inheritance. You got to read that about 10 times. So that's the who. All those who are in Christ are putting sin to death. And that puts us in the same plane, in the same condition, in the same justified place as one another. Now, some of us are further down the road than others. Some of us have more expertise in killing the same sin over and over than somebody who's just come to Christ. So maybe we can be an aid to one another. Maybe we can lock arms with one another a little bit in this. We'll get to that down the road here in a second. And then point D, how. How do I kill sin? Sometimes it's a frustrating thing to have an instruction from Paul and not get all the nuts and bolts of how it works together. But so I think between this passage and the Romans 8:13 passage, there's some clues within the text that tell us about how it is that we work some of this out, along with all of the rest of Scripture. Here I've got some help again from Sinclair Ferguson, and I want to sum up some of his points These are taken from his book, Devoted to God. The first one is this: develop a mindset. Develop a mindset. So the Spirit of God is given to us to enable us to put sin to death. The Spirit of God works through our mind to do so. He addresses our mind. How? Through the Word of God. So the Spirit of God, using the Word of God to change the mind of the believer, and that is the practicalities of putting sin to death. And developing this mindset is connected to four basic thoughts here. The first one is to recognize I need to put sin to death in my life. Two things are true of a Christian: Jesus dwells in me, and sin continues to dwell in me. That's a hard reality. Now, sin has been put to death. It has been paid for. It has been killed. The sin no longer has mastery over me as a believer in Christ, but it still dwells there. And so there are going to be old habits, old thinking patterns, wrong or errant thinking process that has to be still put to death. We're not done in that process. And so you've heard this: the setting apart of my life, or the sanctification of my life, continues on until I see Christ face to face. But my justification is done, paid for, finished, complete before Christ. God the Father looks at me and sees the righteousness of his Son, Jesus Christ. But yet the process of dying to sin continues on in this life. So that's the first thing, is to recognize I need to put sin to death. The second one is responsibility. This is maybe a tough one for those of you in the "I really believe in the sovereignty of God" camp, which I am also. But Paul says that we're the ones who are responsible to put sin to death. We're not passive in this, to where we say, "Lord, just go ahead. I'm just going to sit back and let you cleanse me from all my sin." He tells us you're responsible to be putting sin to death. The Spirit enables us, and without the Spirit, we would be powerless, absolutely powerless. But he doesn't relieve us of that responsibility to live for the glory of God and the glory of Jesus Christ. We have a responsibility to live that way. So we take it upon ourselves to say, what do I need to do to be about the business of killing this sin? Third point is under develop a mindset is ability. Now, with the help of the Holy Spirit, recognize you have the helper. You have the paraclete. You have the comforter. You have the one who gives you power, who comes and indwells you so that you then have the ability to put sin to death. You have an ability. To deny that is to deny what his word has said. And the fourth one is will. Well, you remember when Jesus went to the pool and he said to the paralytic, "Do you want to be healed?" It may seem like a silly question if it wasn't coming from Jesus Christ. The man had been there for, was it 40 years, 37, 40 years or something like that. And he said, "Do you want to be healed?" The man began to make excuse. "Well, when the water is stirred, I have no one to help me get to the pool." Jesus says, "I'm what you need. Do you want to be healed?" The same thing might be asked of us. Do you want to be increasing in holiness? Do you want to overcome sin? Do you want to? Both Paul and Jesus connect the getting rid of sin with some amount of violence and pain. Paul says, put it to death. That's a pretty violent thing to say. Jesus says, if your right eye causes you to sin, gouge it out, throw it away. If your right hand causes you sin, cut it off. Better that you lose members of your body than for your whole body to be thrown in hell. To use the old physical conditioning phrase, no pain, no gain. There is one of my professors in college, Ron Frost, was talking about reading that passage in Matthew chapter 5 about gouging out your right eye or cutting off your right hand, and it doesn't seem like Jesus means it literally. So what is the deal? What is he trying to communicate? Well, what he's trying to communicate is this: God is a holy God. For us to take sin lightly is a great offense to him. Take it seriously. See that there is a desperate work to be done after our salvation to continue to see it put to death. So getting rid of it is something to take seriously. The second part of how to do this is the method of grace, as Ferguson puts it, the method of grace. And he says, number one, recognize you need to deal with the root. And I don't know about you, but I hate weeds in the yard, in the garden, in the planting beds. I hate weeds. And sometimes if you just go along quickly and you try to grab a weed, you snap it off and you leave the root, what happens? It comes right back. It's always better to go slow and to dig deeper and to try to get it out by the root. Sin has deep roots. They go all the way to the heart. Don't merely divert it so that it lives in a different way but less obvious to others. Does that make sense? Don't just say, okay, oh, I'm kind of caught up in that sin. Let me just try to cloak it or hide it in some way. We're told in Scripture to make no provision for the flesh. Make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. The second part of the method of grace is guard your mind. It's not a solution to say, I didn't actually do it, I just thought about it. That's not a solution, because God deals in the realm of the heart. And so thinking about it is a measure of infraction upon a sin, as well as committing it with your body in some way. Jesus makes that clear. Thinking about it's a form of doing it. That's how deep it goes into the folds of our heart. It goes all the way inside. It's like a fibrous presence. It takes a lot of work to root it out and to kill it. The third part is fill the mind. Fill the mind. We seek to flood our minds with the things of the Spirit, right? You chase out a strong man, you replace him with nothing, he comes back with more friends. We instead fill our minds with the things that are good and pure. Philippians 4:8, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there be any excellence, if there is any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. And then number four, live in fellowship. Live in fellowship. Yeah, we are responsible to apply these principles to ourselves as individuals, and yet we're wrong to think that we could not or should go it, that we could or should go it alone. That old illustration, I was reminded of a camp we had several years ago, and one of our speakers, Ryan Allstott, was speaking. This is probably 2011, and he was talking, and he was speaking around this campfire, and he knocked a log off of the fire, and he moved it off by itself on the side. Some of you may remember this, and we watched as the fire continued to blaze, but the single isolated log cooled. Went out, the fire went out. Take a log from the fire, it quickly grows cold. Satan tries to isolate us, and he whispers to us that we've failed and we have no hope. Our fellowship is a major encouragement in reminding us of the hope that we have in our Lord Jesus Christ. In battling sin, do not get to the place where your shame of the sin makes you think that it's a good strategy to just keep it to yourself. We need the fellowship in our battle of this sin. Well, that's our look at this text for today. I know that there's a good possibility that whatever the sin specifically that has been effective in having root in your life that it's probably come to mind today. So let's pray about that. See that we give more ground to Christ in every area of our heart. Lord, we would pray that today, that your words will go to our hearts, that sin that has come to mind for us, that we have perhaps made provision for, that we have allowed it to live in us, and it has dishonored you, and it's been working on destroying us, it would become more detestable in our eyes. That we would address the who, what, why, and how of our sin to put it to death. That we would be passionate and decisive and violent, knowing that it's only possible by the work of your word and your spirit and the body of Christ here with us. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. Thank you for your salvation, so rich and free. And there is truly a freedom that we have been set free for. We praise you for that, God. We praise you for these things and all your word. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, hopefully we see you out at the park. If not, have a wonderful day and a wonderful week. We'll see you next week.